Hello, Licklibrary family, how are you doing? I have shaved my beard in a beard shaving accident, and that was me jamming over the jam track that we created last week when we were looking at 80s guitar, and I thought it was really cool. We're going to use this today as a sort of springboard into developing some ideas which will help us play better solos. Now, disclaimer, in this live stream, I'm a guitar tutor here. I'm on a journey as well of playing, and everything I'm doing is more for demonstration purposes. So, you know, everything I'm playing here isn't necessarily meant to be how you should play in the real world. These are just ideas that kind of help you develop your technique and intention. So we're going to discuss that today. I'm just going to have a look at the chat and see who's in today. Hi. Oh, hi, Mark from the home of NAM. Good to see you. I can see Martin, I can see Keith Moff, hello, how you doing? We've got Timothy, Lil from Ohio, hello. Martin White, how are you doing? I'm trying to see all these names, all coming in. Cool, it's lovely to see you all. I hope you're all fantastic and well, and you're having a good week and continue to have a good weekend and all that stuff. So we're going to talk about soloing. So just to bring up this project from last week. Okay, so this is the backing track that I kind of came up with. Let's just have a listen to it, get it in our ears. We're in the good rock and roll key of E minor. These are the parts we came up last week. So that's going to be our kind of ground. That could be a solo section in a song. It could be just a jam track, an instrumental part we're working on. And it depends, of course, on the intentionality behind what you're writing. And I'm going to talk today a bit. It's going to be a mixture between writing and improvising. But right there, we've just got these very simple chords going on. Let's zoom in on the guitar neck. I'm going to turn the distortion off. We got, if you weren't here last week, we had E minor down to C. It's a very simple chord progression. In fact, these chords, for the theory minded, E minor and C major are very closely related, really. C major 7 has an E minor triad right inside of it. So actually, it's kind of difficult to make soloing over something like this sound interesting, because you are kind of playing over two very similar tonalities. So just in the key of E minor. But there's so many tracks that use this cadence in the solo sections, or in a verse, or in a chorus. It's a typical 80s thing. So we're going to look at sort of five things. I'm going to go over them briefly now, actually. We've got motivic development, or repetition, or creating a theme. We've got contrast, which is huge. I'm going to talk about how to practice these and how they sound and how effective these can be. The use of space. We've got trajectory, or storytelling, and that's often forgotten. And then we've got the most important thing, perhaps, probably, is tone and technique and intention, because these are things which are really going to... That's your voice. That's the voice of what you're playing. Now, as I go through, I'd love to know in the comments what some of your favourite things are about solos, some of your favourite solos, and why you like them. And if you can sort of discern, and it'd be helpful for us all to share this, aspects of it that you like. Now, often when I'm teaching, I talk about some of these limitations, things like storytelling and repetition, and I get students not only to transcribe their solos, meaning learn them by ear and memorize them and be able to play along with them properly and understand what's going on theoretically and play it technically. All of that stuff is given, but perhaps just as important, if not more important slightly, would be to understand the picture of the solo, like what is actually going on in terms of where it is. Is there contrasting phrases? Is there tension and release? Is it going from single notes to chords? Is there a melody from within the rest of the song in the solo? Things like that. These are like universal things you can pick out. And that, I dare say that they actually become more applicable to your own playing in a shorter amount of time than working on licks. However, you do need to work on licks as well. So, Rock Bottom, Mark Crandall says, Rock Bottom by UFO, one of my all-time favourite solos. All Along the Watchtower, says Chris A. Fantastic, yeah, All Along the Watchtower, beautiful. Great solos. So, you know, take those. I'd like, for example, those two solos, Chris and Mark, if you may have done this already, but my suggestion, if anybody wants to make the most of today's webinar, is to take some of the limitations that I look at today, concepts, and then listen back to your favorite solos and see if you can hear where those things are, because they should be hopefully universal. So let's just talk about let's go into the first one. I'm just gonna get my list up. What was it again? So the tone and technique, first of all, I think that's going to be perhaps one of the first places to focus on. So if we listen to the track again, I'll get the guitar on the screen and just listen to the track. It's hard rock, okay? And there's a very straight... You know, I can get away with a crunchy... Turn off the chorus. You know, you could go crunchy, a bit more distortion might work as well. Now, you know, first of all, tone isn't just in literally the gear we're using. You know, it could be how I pick. I mean, like I said, this is just teaching. This is not meant to be a good solo or anything like that. But the difference between intentionality between... So, you know, an example that was just bridge pickup and neck pickup taking me on a completely different road. And also, I was thinking differently, not necessarily about what I was playing with licks, I was thinking about the sound that I'm making with the guitar. And I think one thing that I am guilty of, especially on some of these live streams when I'm kind of caught up teaching and presenting, or when I'm, you know, when we've learned a solo, maybe we're doing a cover of a solo, learning one of our favorite solos, we can kind of shout it out because we've just learned it, we've learned the licks, and we kind of overstate the notes, and it can be a bit stiff sounding. And we end up with tension. Great Ben Eller video the other day about sorting out your picking, and he just, you know, it's something that reminded me. And I was watching Brian May actually doing some of his sort of soloing, and he talks about holding the pick very lightly. And apparently Eddie Van Halen was very similar as well. He held the pick very lightly, and that enabled the pick to have just a bit of give, even though he's playing with the shreddy licks. It changed the tone dramatically. So whilst this is very obvious, do kind of listen out for that when you're learning solos, and also when you're writing solos, like double check. Like, there's so much you can get out of, you know. This is the lick of the day for me. I don't know why. Volume. Can you bend? There's so many different ways of just articulating those same notes, and that's you know, already one fantastic way of developing solos. Now, the other thing that might be mentioned here is, once you have that in the can, once you've kind of decided what's the tone, what's the attack, what's the feel really that's going on, then it's to then look for motivic development, which sounds very academic. I wrote that down, repetition. So let's just do an example of some repetition. You know, I did a solo a few weeks ago, and someone came in with a comment saying how ranty my solo was, and it was because I was just not thinking, and it ended up, you know, sort of thing. And whilst maybe you know, 2 out of 10 of those licks might sound cool in isolation, I don't know if anything was actually said there that was any, you know, really adding to anybody's lives. So using repetition is the first thing, and also it enables you to use less already. Let's just take a lick, right? I'm gonna start the solo. I was talking about limitations last week. I was thinking about, you know, maybe starting our solo with something picked. Okay, so I've now given myself a limitation of creating something scalic and picked, but now I'm going to work on, okay, well, rather than just going, you know, playing up a run, maybe I develop a motif. I'm just going to improvise this, see if I can start out in that area and pause. So straight away, I didn't expect that to happen. I started out of just... And then I finished out, it took me into a different place. I didn't just continue the sequence. I could have a call and response within the phrase. And space is really important. It's very easy to feel kind of nervous and feel like you need to fill space. But actually, maybe I'll repeat that phrase a few times. Now, if I was writing, I would have probably hopefully been recording that. I didn't do that at that time. But there was something in there. I made a bit of a mistake, but it surprised me. I went off into a new trajectory, which I wouldn't have done otherwise. I could have easily started doing some licks and things like that. But using the repetition and a bit of space to listen to what just happened, I'm able to move with it. So maybe going back to, you know, I've got these limited amount of bars. To do a solo, I'm going to delete this bit. We're only going to solo over this purple section here, and we're going to start out with that kind of idea. So maybe we can record an idea, just improvise around the idea I just came up with. Okay, so I don't know if that recorded actually. Oh, it did. Okay, so let's say it's not a Grammy Award winning solo. I can see some people writing some amazing solos in there. We've got Rising Force. Wow, Strangers in the Night. Oh, there's so many good solos here. I think I'm gonna have to go back through the comments after this and find the ones I've not heard and listen to them. Although, you know, Hotel California, you cannot beat that. So I was listening to that in the car the other night on the way back from a gig, and I just turned it right up, and wow, yeah, that's incredible. Made me almost tear up. It was so good. So I used that limitation to create the opening to the solo. I dig that. Now, because we want to now add some contrast, and let's do this relative to what we've got there. We started out with a heavily picked run. I can't remember what I meant. And then I had this feeling, I could hear it in my head. It just popped out. I couldn't have thought of that if I hadn't given myself a chance to sort of repeat things. Now I might keep that kind of idea going. I'm not going to suddenly jump elsewhere, but I'd like to maybe contrast that with something a bit higher, maybe a bit more legato, because that would be different to the picking. So we're changing two things, and let's just higher up, more legato, and also actually, yeah, most of the phrasing here, that is. It's, you know, a very straight feel. There's no triplet feel there. So to contrast that first phrase, we've got three things to think about: going higher, going more legato, so less staccato picky, and we're going to also hopefully use some kind of triplet rhythm. So we'll play, I'll record this live, and this is not really, just see what happens. So we're going to hear the first one. Okay, maybe I probably went on a bit too far there, but I kind of like the idea of actually starting. I'm going to delete that. I'm going to go back to it. Trying to bring in that theme again. Let's just go back again. Okay, so I managed to, this is a good example actually. I probably gave myself too many things to think about, but I did go legato and I did move up the neck right there. And immediately, I'm not saying this is any good, but I would say that it's, I'm just gonna check the levels of these two guitars so when we listen back, it's kind of a bit more matched. Hopefully it tells a bit more of a story than the first solo that I played. Okay, now I'm seeing comments actually, something about building, and this is really good time actually. Mark says about who brought this up. Which solo are we looking at? Symphony for Destruction. No, that's an incredible solo. So you know what we're going to do now. I mean, there's another thing I want to bring up, and I've got to get back to it. And it's keeping things within a set time and actually reaching the end of the story and telling a story in the first place, but. We're kind of moving through now to the next section. So I kind of heard. Now I think we're going to go higher up and we're going to go a bit quicker. I'm going to go back to some picking, I think. Let's just see what happens. Okay, so that was another improvised. I recorded that one just for the thing. But something that happened there, again, especially if you want things to stand out, was rather than just playing endless licks there, I tried to at least give the start of that speed picking lick something with a stop and then repeating it again. And then I kind of went off on one. And when I was doing it, I felt a bit like, oh no, I've gone too far. It felt wrong. So then I thought, well, to contrast this, to go into some blues. So I went into some of those bluesy bends, and that kind of took me out there. Now, again, I'm in teacher mode. I enjoy teaching, actually, because it kind of brings out some stuff in my own playing. It reminds me of what I need to work on. But straight away, as terms of practice, this gets you thinking. Now, recording yourself, I'm using Cubase here. You can get Cubase pretty cheap. I'm going to save that actually. You can practice kind of constructing solos. Now, whilst it's not necessarily improvisation, you can start to hear those changes in your own playing, and you can make objective decisions about how you sound. You can say, okay, that sound, you know, I can listen back to this and say my vibrato here wasn't that great or whatever, so I'll change that next time, or oh, I like that lick, I'm going to develop that more. And it's quite a nice way of kind of auditing your playing and hearing it back at the same time as a way of practicing. So, that being said, you need to also think about here. I'm going to go off on one here. And this is a bit of a plug as well for the Lick Library membership. But backing tracks are really great to practice along to. And I'm sure many of us here jam along to jam tracks and backing tracks, and you know, just blues tracks or rock tracks or jazz tracks, funk. And normally these tracks are like 5 or 6 minutes long. And unless it's a Steve Vai or Satriani album, there's no 6 minute long solo. Maybe a Johnny Winter song, I'm not sure. Or maybe Gary Moore or somebody might have something like that on an album. But really, most great solos, some of the solos that people are mentioning here, they happen within 8, 16, 32 bars, or maybe even less sometimes. Or maybe they're just part of something else, you know, they're part of a song. So it's always good to remember the solo should complement the song. And also, when you're practicing to backing tracks, you are practicing the habits of your playing. And if you've got a 6 minute long backing track, it's very easy to go into meandering territory like I do sometimes, most of the time. So actually giving yourself a limitation, like work out like how long is the one repeat of the chord progression on the backing track, and just limit yourself to only playing and trying to tell a story within that time. It could be, and work out how many bars it is, count it out, write down the chords above the bars so you can see what you're playing over, and just focus on applying some of these limitations within it to tell a story. You know, contrast, doing different rhythms and things like that, or you know, repeating a motif, or starting out really quiet, getting louder, or starting even as simple as, you know, starting out low, very low on the fretboard, and then starting to. Now these build, people talking about building, it's about really kind of like teasing your way up the fretboard rather than just sort of, you know, maybe at the end of a solo. But if you really want to build something, you've really got to create that tension. You've got to give you're kind of leaving breadcrumbs for the listener and yourself to respond to in order to say something. So, yeah. Okay. So I did see a question about picking, which I'm going to get to. But before I do that, I just want to talk about a course at Lick Library, which I have been jamming along to. It's one of my favorite series at Lick Library. It's called Jam With. But it's jammed with one of the tutors. And what this course is really good at is the tutor will... There's three backing tracks per course. And then the tutor will demonstrate, introduce a concept like a scale or technique. And then you trade with the artist. So here it's Danny Gill, one of my favourite tutors and favourite players at Lick Library. I love them all, but Danny, you know, Danny's one of the legends. And you get to trade back and forth, and that's really good. It's like sitting down with someone in your living room and having a jam. Just check this out. Oops, play.
All right, so I've just finished doing a DVD called Jam with Danny Gill. So this DVD is quite a bit different from other DVDs that I've done in the sense that this is kind of my perspective on soloing. And the way this DVD is set up, we take three backing tracks. So we'll have one jam, and within that jam, I'll place just some basic ideas, and I'll solo a little bit, and then it'll be your turn to solo. We'll take maybe 16 bars and just go back and forth. And then we'll take that same jam, and I'll take some more advanced ideas, more at an intermediate level, and we'll go back and forth. And then I'll take that same jam, and we'll do it at a more advanced level, take some more advanced concepts over the same chord progression, and we'll go back and forth. So to set up each jam, I also talk about some of the ideas that I'll be using. So maybe it's pentatonic stuff, maybe it's sequencing the scale. Maybe for a more advanced idea, I'll talk about modes that I'll be using, how to switch scales when soloing over the same group of chords. So there's quite a bit involved. I get through a lot of techniques here, some two-hand tapping stuff, some string skipping stuff, as well as just some basic bends, just some basic short licks. but just take you through how to solo over each of these tracks effectively, no matter what level you happen to be at. So because this DVD has three separate backing tracks, I tried to make each of the backing tracks sound a little bit different. So one has kind of a swing feel to it, so I talk about how to solo with a swing feel.
There we are. I mean, Danny is the man. I've got a jam with as well, but Danny, you can, if you're not a member, you can watch the previews for free and see all the trailers and see if you're interested. Check out the Licklibrary membership, of course, because you do get even more. And you get one-to-one with Stu Shields, who will help you kind of find your learning path on the website. It's really cool, really cool. So going back to my guitar solo, let's have a listen again to what I did earlier. Here's one I made earlier. So we're starting out that hip side there. Legato and higher up. Then we went more shreddy and picked. Bluesy, because I was trying to apologize for the shred. Now, in an improvisation, that's really helpful to have these things kind of in the back of your mind. If you're doing a set or something and you know there's certain songs coming up, you can use this. You can say, okay, I've got this particular song, I'm gonna pick like this, I'm gonna do something like this. You kind of create that thing in your mind, and it kind of puts you on a different trajectory rather than just kind of playing whatever your fingers are doing. You know, again, I was listening to the Guitar Interactive interview with Brian May, Jamie Humphries and Brian May, and, you know, Brian's talking about, you know, he likes to play with intentionality, and he'll often write his solos by singing them or something in his head, then he'll work it out on guitar because it sounds cool. It's more intentional, especially as a composing guitarist. That's really important. But as an improvising guitarist, it becomes useful. Now, it does challenge your flexibility on the fretboard, because when we're using these more universal principles of, okay, low and picky, high and legato, or contrasting rhythms, it does require that you draw upon various techniques that you may already have, but it then repurposes why you're learning techniques. And recording yourself is really good, because you start to work out, I'd like to do that more than that thing I think I wanted to do, but actually I just don't really feel like doing it. Let's work on something more worthwhile. That can be a really cool idea. Now, just another really important aspect of, I want to go back to contrast just briefly, actually, because it's a really cool one, which is just simply rhythms. You know, you got the rhythm of the backing track again. So eighth notes. Or triplets. Sixteenths, you might find, if you're finding you're playing a bit stagnant, you know, mix up the rhythms. Obviously, going between a straight rhythm and a triplet rhythm is going to be a good one. If I improvise, I'll do something a bit more melodic, but so right there, I sort of, I don't know what I did. That was it. Something, I missed it a bit. But I went from some very eighth notey rhythm, one and two and three and four, and then I did a more a triplet-y thing, and then I went kind of riding around on a bar. Nowadays, there's loads of amazing guitar players, more in a sort of modern progressive guitar movement, and they can play super lovely, you know, in-time subdivision stuff. But then some of what's missing, I think, is also that just hairy over the bar line things. You know, if you go back to something like this, if I go from in-time legato, 16s, that's cool, but what about you know, some of those like legato and tapping licks, you know, and if you listen to Yngwie and stuff, he goes between in time and also just note cramming. If anybody here's tried to learn like a, I don't know, a Red Beach solo or a Joe Satriani solo, and you look at the legato on some of the old tab books, you see these terrifying looking kind of spider diagrams going across the page. But really, most of that stuff is just within the phrasing and it's kind of floating around the beat. And it's good to have control of both. That's what I would just suggest. That's another contrasting element. And I think that's probably why I sometimes get a bit bored on Instagram. Bored and jealous, which is a weird combination to be. But yeah, I like the kind of flowing out of time thing. So here we go. So I'm trying to think of, have I missed any of these lovely options? I'm just going to check in my phone here. And let's check in with some comments. Has anybody got any questions? Has anybody got any things I might have missed? Because you know, there's some things in here which might be useful for, you know, for each of us to learn from. I always love hearing from, you know, I'm here being a teacher, but I'm not really a teacher. We're all teaching each other. So let us know if there's any other elements you could think of to work on in the playing. Whilst you're thinking of questions, I just want to go back now to the lovely licklibrary.com, and I've got another course I want to kind of plug. And it's killer pop solos. It's one of my courses. And it's 10 classic solos which have been in the charts, basically. There's like Maniac, there's Beat It, and many more. Kid Charlemagne. And one thing I'd add to all of this is, if you want to make great solos, you've got to learn great solos. And that's really helpful because you kind of see all this stuff in action, and to go back with the idea of, ah, what's the contrast here, what's the motif, what's the storyline trajectory, where does it start and where does it end, those things can be really useful to think about when you're learning some of these solos. So I'm just going to quickly just play this trailer, and hopefully I'll do a bit of it. I start talking a bit too much and you're already hearing lots of me, so I will pause it early abruptly, but check it out. It's killer pop solos.
So I've just finished filming a brand new course for Lick Library, looking at 10 killer pop solos from different eras of popular music. The guitarists on these solos are all fantastic. You have the likes of Larry Carlton, Eddie Van Halen, Michael Cimbello, and even Steve Lukather is in there. There's so many things to learn from these solos. I've really enjoyed learning some solos, which I really should have learned a long time ago, and they taught me so much as I learned them. Things like bending, vibrato, timing, picking runs, legato, articulation and phrasings. It's really important to learn quality guitar solos if you want to really expand your phrasing as a guitarist. This course could be approached by many different levels of guitar player. There are some really awesome bluesy rock solos which have simple phrases and really are masterclasses in articulation and phrasing. And there's of course some really, really intense out there stuff with Larry Carlton, and the Beat It solo from Michael Jackson by Eddie Van Halen. that's pretty intense to learn. There's so many things to do and master in that solo. So I had a really big challenge to be able to play all these solos myself, but I learned a lot. You can be a beginner intermediate guitarist and have lots to take away and enough to challenge you, but also keep you satisfied in your learning in this course. So if you're looking for new phrasing ideas and licks and to improve your technique, or you're just looking to learn some new repertoire and classic guitar solos, then you have to check out this course. It's for you.
There we are. So that's I can see some cool comments coming in, and I can see a discussion. David Tompkins asks, how do you rein in excess? Well, first of all, space. Record yourself playing. That's brutal, because straight away you can, if you just record yourself noodling and playing and then listen to it back, you'll often hit one of the first things that you can do to clean things up is leave a few more gaps so you can hear what might come next. And it doesn't mean necessarily playing slower, you can still shred, but I would definitely suggest space. It just gives you a bit more intentionality. I did see a comment as well. Oh, okay. I was asking about picking technique. Ah, yes, there were some people asking about picking technique. I can't remember what happened. I was probably... probably digging in too much there. So picking, I've always just picked from the wrist. Try not to hold a pick too hard. Try not to put too much pick below the string. Try to follow the trajectory of the pickups when you're going up a run, rather than going of the wrist curve, which ends up giving you this motion. Practice in speed bursts. Don't just practice, you know, 16th notes for hours. Work on just work on getting something fast, but in a short amount of time. And then you can build. First of all, the one thing I'm not saying here is always start slow. Pick shouldn't move any further than the string, really. I'm using just a general pick. I like different types of picks at different times in my life, but for today I'm using this. And it's keeping it light, you know. I work a lot with just letting go of tension, making sure the fingers are, you know, you're not getting any. I mean that's cool if you want that effect, but that, so you're not kind of mandolining. You know, falling down the stairs sort of thing. So hopefully that helps. I mean, just keeping it light. I've got a course actually at Lick Library called Rock Foundations Alternate Picking. Check it out. That's got a lot of my philosophy of picking. I don't think it's changed too much since, apart from practicing smaller segments and practicing different rhythms. Because rather than just locking into just like 16ths or triplets, like, you know, being able to play something that's like a bit more, you know, something that moves around a bit. That was a weird example, but hopefully you get me. Martin says, what can we do to make it more interesting with our note choice? Switch from E minor to C minor. Throw in some harmonic minor. Basically, there's only 12 notes. Most keys, only whatever chord you're playing over is about as interesting as you can get it to. You know, you can learn over dominant chords. You can do lots of cool things and, you know, you can start to... you do things like that, but over this backing track, for example, if I try to force harmonic minor, over C, that note's not happening. So there's no point in necessarily learning more scales. It's more about taking what you know and doing all the things I'm talking about here, is like working on different rhythmic phrasing, repetition, starting your licks on different beats. That's something else, actually, something I didn't mention. you know, taking, let's say I got a run. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, 1. What if I do it on a one hand? You know, that's a simple way of actually just getting more for your buck. You know, when you're playing, chords are modes. You know, these E minor is mode 6 and C major in this key is mode 4, Lydian, but they're just sounds of the chords. Chords and scales are the same thing. And forcing a scale over something it's not really related to doesn't really work. And actually, it becomes more about using less notes rather than using more notes to get creative things. For example, like over this E minor chord, I could play E minor arpeggios, of course. What about a G major 7 arpeggio? So over E minor, G major 7 arpeggio. Or how about a B minor arpeggio over that E minor? You know, you can, I kind of went off on one a bit there, but you start to take what's within those notes already and do more of them. And always go back to listening to great solos. You know, that's the key. You'll find that most players aren't using all seven positions of the major scale. They're not, most music, all those top solos that are in the charts, not, I don't think, only a couple of them might even go outside of the regular pentatonic minor scale, major scale thing. Maybe a bit of chromaticism here and there, but you know, you can get a lot out of just what's already there. So Timothy asked a good question. You are so right about other music. Yes, sorry, that's not a question. Yes, learning other people's solos is really important. Whatever style you're in, if you want to get good at that style, learn the solos. You know, it's like Victor Wooten talks about, you know, he doesn't practice, it's all play. We don't learn to speak by, I don't know, we don't get given like a dictionary when we're born and then expect to go into a conversation. We learn by jamming, testing, finding the appropriate words, and we end up with sentences that we don't know we're saying, but they get a result, and then eventually we know what they mean, and then we can manipulate them and make them our own. So it's the same sort of thing with guitar playing, really. You've got to sort of ingest and a lot of listening, and this is what I'm saying at the start. Listening to solos, learning the licks and all that stuff, understanding the theory. It's funny because when you start to understand the theory of all the solos that you love, you'll realize most of them are, there's not many licks really going around in most rock and metal. There is, but the creativity is in the placement, the tone, the context of the music. Danish Pete, I remember jamming with him quite a bit, and he would often say, you know, I've only got four licks, but I love interesting chord progressions that I can use these licks over. So if you really want to take your solo into the next level, understanding your chords and progressions is the key, and that's the magic of any kind of cinematic, at least, sounding solo. Of course, the straight ahead rock stuff, you know, shredding over one chord, awesome too. So yeah, any other questions? I'm just going to just double check through the comments. One thing I would mention, actually, before we finish up, you know, you can, you know, use a different effects, using tremolo, using chorus, using different reverbs within a solo. I remember hearing a live recorded DI of Paul Gilbert playing Technical Difficulties. And, you know, for me in the outside, I've always assumed that he just plugged in and had his amp, but he was putting on phaser and slapback delay at certain points in the song. And I noticed that it was lifting and dropping and changing the character, especially in that kind of guitaristic music where it can just be a wall of guitar, just having some contrasting sounds. This is one of the reasons why Surfing with the Alien is such a cool album, because Satriani didn't want to use conventional gear. I love conventional gear, but his point was to have different sounds as textures rather than having a nice tone. I think having a nice tone and is a very kind of YouTube, Instagram thing. A nice tone is kind of subjective to the song and the player and the context of everything. You know, like if Pantera would not sound great with, I mean, it could sound cool with a kind of periphery tone, but it's Pantera's tone. It sounds cool. Darkness wouldn't sound good with like a super polished, you know, Axe FX tone or something like that. So tone is really important, experimenting with that. So there we are. I've got one more little course I just want to promote very quickly. I want to just introduce everyone to this guy. This is Richard Shaw. I don't know if anybody has seen his lessons at Lick Library yet. He's an incredible guitar player. He's recently started working with Lick Library, and he's played with Cradle of Filth. He does so many sessions, King. He's a great metal guitarist, great blues and jazz guitarist. And he's just released a series called Top Solos of the Noughties. And I'm just going to just play you the intro, just introduce you to him. This is his lesson on Avenged Sevenfold's Backcountry, which is a fantastic modern metal solo. Here we go.
Hi, Rich here, and today I'm going to walk you through the solo in Backcountry by Avenged Sevenfold, a fantastic solo by Sinister Gates. Plenty of technique, some crazy scales, some crazy outside playing going on, lots of sweeping, and a great harmony section at the end. So here's the main solo without the harmony section at the end.
Monstrous. Obviously, that's the, you know, Richard Shaw is an awesome guitarist. Avenged Sevenfold out solo is brilliant. That actually just that kind of demonstrates my point earlier about chords. Without you could, he was kind of highlighting those chords in the solo right there. Obviously, the backing for that solo is quite an interesting one. It moves around and modulates, and obviously the solo has to follow that. And there's lots of arpeggio ideas. There's lots of development of motifs right there. It's kind of a good example, but it's also a good example of, I mean, that's, and it sounds awesome, but it doesn't make much sense without the music as well. Everything is interrelational, interdependent, as the Buddhists say. It's all kind of co-arising. It has to be together to make the things. The solo is only as good as the song and the backing and all that good stuff. You know, Final Countdown, I think I saw written in the comments, it's one of those perfect examples. It's got a beautiful chord progression. There's a lot of motivic development moving up. So there we are. I can see everybody saying thank you. I really appreciate it. I'm really glad that you've joined me tonight. I hope you're doing well. You have lessons on Lick Library, Julian asks. Of course, I've got so many lessons at Lick Library. If you're a member, there's hundreds of lessons from me. And if you're not a member, there's lots of classic album courses. There's so much there. I've done... currently working on Guns N' Roses Use Your Illusion number one, but we just finished Def Leppard, Pyromania, and an earlier, I think we've done Porno Graffiti by Extreme, we've done David Lee Roth, Eat 'em and Smile, I've done Moving Pictures by Rush, I did Night at the Opera by Queen, I did Van Halen 2, Van Halen 5150, that's the one I did Nirvana's Nevermind, that was fun, I love that. I did some Buddy Holly DVD. I've done loads of lessons and courses on theory and technique. So if you are interested, you can preview the lessons. Check out a membership. If you're not a member, do sign up. Give it a month. See what you think. And just get in there and get some cool lessons. Lick Library is meant to be like sitting down with somebody in your room or house, living room, chair, and showing you some cool stuff. That's what we're about. Sharing the journey. You know, all I can see, I've been on this path, and all I can do is say left a bit, right a bit. But I'm still on the path as well. So it's all good. All right. Okay, I'm gonna wrap it up there. But fantastic. Take care. Be kind to each other. Be kind to yourself. Happy practicing, and listen to your favorite solos using some of those ideas of trajectory and repetition and all that good stuff. And really, you know, create some of your own solos as well. I'd be interested to hear from you how that goes. Have a good night.